Good morning, everyone. Those of you who have just joined us, we on our pre-show show. And David's on camera with me this morning. So we're getting things ready, binoculars, and wake myself up a little bit. It's a nice early morning. Beautiful morning. Nice and cool, actually, out here. So let's see what we can find this morning. What else do I need to check, Dave? Done everything here.
Got a fire hydrant.
Got a fire extinguisher. Did you sleep well, Dave?
Not
really. So it's about 23 degrees Celsius and 73 degrees Fahrenheit, so not as warm as we are used to, which is nice. Those of you who've just joined us, this is just a pre-show introduction. We're just getting things ready, working on our communications, making sure the radios are working, doing our little checks. James is on the other vehicle this morning, and oh well, I suppose, seeing as it's a pre-show drive, we'll show you something quickly just to entice you a little bit. Elephant. But because this is not the actual show, I won't speak about him too much. I'll just show you him. There are rules to be followed. Kirsten is laughing at me in the final control. Oh, this is so cool. What a nice little start to the morning. So our plan this morning, actually, everyone, is we are going to try and find a female leopard, Karula, and her two cubs. So we will leave. Oh, what do you have to do again? You've got to pull the key out a bit.
That's right.
So also need to work on starting the vehicle. That's very important for a morning safari. Something dead. Can you smell that? I think it's that buffalo the lions had the other day. Can definitely smell. The smell of carrion, the dead buffalo. There are beautiful male lion tracks heading along the road in that direction. So opposite direction to what we are going. But I think that James may have found them. Yes, I think James may have found them. Who knows? It's a surprise. It's a surprise for when the show starts. Yeah, these lions walked all along the road. Lovely seeing fresh lion tracks in the morning. But we're not looking for lions, we're looking for leopard. So we need leopard tracks. What else can we discuss, Dave? Oh, the Chicago Cubs won the World Series. Did you know that? Yeah. So some of my friends live in Chicago, and I used to play baseball, which was cool. I really enjoyed it. And the Cubs won the World Series. So if you're a Cubs fan, go Cubs. Yeah, I enjoyed baseball. It was a lot of fun.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Just reassuring each other after that. Watch, the line is coming now, just from the right-hand side. And now she's having a drink, basically under your foot. What a fantastic way to start a day. So this is the full Nkuhuma pride. 5 lionesses, 8 cubs, and that male, part of a coalition called the Birmingham Boys. And there are 4 of them. If you listen very carefully, you might just be able to hear the lapping of the tongues. Perfect, perfect start to the morning. The cub going up to the male? That's unusual. Don't see that all the time. Often they're a bit nervous of the males. He's now, if you watch him, he's doing what we call a Fremen grimace. He's trying to tell if the female is ready to mate or not. And all the little ones going up to say hello, but you can see they're a little reticent. That's very sweet. I just killed 2 buffalo yesterday, so they're probably quite thirsty. And that male doesn't, it's that female there. It's causing him his angst. He doesn't like her being around. And the one on the ground in front of him, you can see lying in sort of supplication. Her ears flat. He does not want her to move, and he doesn't want her distracted by the rest of the pride. Anyone trying to distract her is going to get themselves into trouble. All the while, these lionesses drink muddy water just below and to the left. Oh, it's just wonderful watching the males play with the little cubs like that. Just careful of this lioness in front of us, everybody. She's looking into your eyes. Brilliant. Hang on.
Oh, we're in the zone now.
The sun is just about to peep up over the eastern horizon now. You can see it slowly getting brighter, the light turning gold. In the background, hear a special bird called a ground hornbill calling.
All right, everyone, not sure if James actually has comms at the moment or what's going on there, but fantastic that he found the pride. So good morning, my name is Byron, and on camera is Dave with me this morning. It's lovely to have all of you again on Safari Live. It's a nice cool morning. And we are in search of leopards. So we are looking for Karula, a female leopard, for those of you who are new viewers, a beautiful female leopard who has got 2 cubs at the moment. And we heard somebody caught a glimpse of her last night in this area. Not entirely sure which direction she went, but that's what we're looking for today. And it is a beautiful morning, 23 degrees Celsius, about 73 degrees Fahrenheit. So nice and cool. Have a look at these male impala here quickly, everyone. Let's see if they fight. It's interesting, it's not mating season or rutting season, but the males seem to be, we saw some males earlier this morning that were also fighting. Testing each other. They are beautiful antelope, aren't they? Look at those males. They appear to be in quite good condition, a little hungry actually. You can see they are a little thin, so they hopefully with some more rain there'll be more food around. However, this area that we are in, and we are situated in the northeastern part of South Africa, in the Greater Kruger National Park, and more closely situated in the Sabi Sand Game Reserve, and we are on Juma. And it is so funny. Now, the Sabi Sands is about 60,000 hectares, so roughly around 130,000 acres of land. And it's all open to the... Sorry, everyone, just listening. I can hear impalas snorting, but it's actually males fighting. And you can hear the difference because they're moving around quite quickly, and it's just a very short snort, not a proper alarm call. So as I was saying, within this Sabi Sands area, it is all open to the Greater Kruger, so the animals can move freely wherever they want. But this section that we are on at the moment, for some reason, has got quite a lot of rainfall recently, more so than others. So it is looking a lot greener here than it is 10 miles south, which is very, very interesting. All right, I believe that James' comms are back up, so let's cross over to him. He's with the lions, and let's chat to James a little bit.
Oh, hang on a second. I'm just going to move. Hello, everybody. I do apologize for my reticence. I'll tell you what happened earlier. It was a... I didn't plug my earpiece in, which is very stupid. There's quite a lot of kind of anger going on here. I'm just going to back up slightly. I don't want to be quite in this line of fire. And what's going on is that the male is being very irritated by the females, mainly because he's trying to mate with the one he's following over there. And he's... just every time she goes near any of the others, he gets really upset and he starts chasing them. And then the cubs scatter and the lionesses scatter, and it's all action here. So good morning. I'm sorry I didn't greet you earlier. I didn't know what was going on, and it was entirely my fault. I apologize profusely. My name is James. Brian's on camera. Hello, Brian.
Hi, James.
How are you on Saturday?
No, I'm good.
There's the Saturday thumb, everybody. And here we are with the full Nkuhuma Pride, 5 lionesses, 8 little cubs, and of course one male lion who's trying to mate with a female who's probably not quite in full estrus yet. Now they're just kind of calling to each other. And what you did was tell us, everyone, of course, that there were lions on the dam wall. So we came down here, just the male and the female. Then as we got here at about 10 to 5, the rest of them came wandering out of the bushes to the western side of where we are. And I think they did that. They've come from Arethusa last night. And there's a great deal of playing, which is wonderful. That's just great. There's the one with the floppy ear, I think, isn't it? Trying still to suckle. Now, I have to tell you, I'm slightly disappointed in myself, but I think that I've only... I can't remember exactly how old they are. I think we're looking at... 6 months, it must be almost 6 months, the biggest ones, and then 5 months probably plus minus, and then maybe 4 months after that. I don't know, it might be slightly younger than that, say 5, 4 and 3. Does anybody remember exactly when they were born? I think the teddies were born in July, if I'm not mistaken, so August, which would put them at 3 months. The teddies being the three youngest. And the other two were about 3 weeks after that, before that. So that would put them just younger, just older, about a month older. Now let's go with 3, 4 and 5, unless anybody can remember otherwise. It's quite astounding how we forget these things. Now you can of course talk to us through the course of the morning. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. The confusion this morning was caused by, firstly, my idiocy, and secondly, they were standing right next to us, of course, which you saw, And so we just fired up that VR rig thing on the front of the car just to try and get one of those virtual reality shots. But no matter, here we are. I hope you'll forgive me. I hope the directors and the final control will forgive me. I might not be allowed home today, Brian.
No, me neither.
You, no, definitely not you.
Mm.
It's a most gorgeous morning after what was a hot and sticky and itchy night, I must say. But here we are in the coolth of the dawn. Sun not yet quite popped over the eastern horizon. And we have magnificent lion sighting. It's a teddy chasing down a cousin. And of course we must just quickly mention that there is this state of mange that the little ones have. There you can see it on the elbows of that one there. And I don't think they're looking too weak. Oh dear. Now Kevin, as we see that, you say you think a male once killed a cub. Kevin, no, don't worry. A male didn't kill the cubs. We've got all 8 here. I tell you what though, when we did get here, I thought that there were only 7. And then a lioness emerged with the other one a little bit later. But if you count them, they're all here. Let me just do it for you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Hang on. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Oh, hang on, I'm sure we saw 8. We did see 8, didn't we? Yes. Oh, there's one in the bushes there. There are 8. So they're all here, Kevin. Fear not. That male has been pretty vicious, and I watched some amazing footage yesterday, but I don't know who got it, but it was, well, it was someone here, but it was a male pulling a cub off a carcass. Was it you, Brian? There's some elephants screaming there.
No.
And what the, it was a buffalo carcass. The male was eating on the bottom of the jaw, and one of the cubs was sort of lying on the carcass trying to get into the skin underneath, and the male got irritated, swatted him once, and the cub didn't move. The male actually retaliated, at least the cub retaliated. The male then grabbed the cub, stuck his claws into that kind of skin behind the head, and pulled the cub off the carcass and tossed it to the ground. The cub, undaunted, then tried to swat the male in the face. So they really are already very tough little creatures. Brian, should we try for that eye-level view again? Mm. Or are you happy here?
No, it's fine.
Now I'm just going to move down here. Right, okay, Liz, thank you very much for that. You say the oldest of these cubs was born mid-June and the youngest mid-July. So there's only a month between them. So the oldest ones, as we head to mid-November, July, August, September, October, November, will be 5 months. So that was correct. 5 months, 4.5 months, and 4 months. Thank you very much for that, Liz. We'll remember that. Middle of June, they're only 2 weeks apart then, each litter. Middle of June, middle of July. And we always quite like these eye-level views because it gives you kind of a interesting impression of the lions. Okay, we're not going anywhere, but Byron has managed to spot a great ball of hydrogen gas and nuclear explosions on the eastern horizon.
Yes, James, sounds something like what happened to you this morning with your opening. But we do have a beautiful sunrise, everyone. Magnificent sunrise. Look at those wispy clouds and that ball of fire in the distance on the horizon. So I think we will have to give James a little slap on the wrist this morning, because I understand that he didn't do the opening correctly, and that is just not done, James. Isn't that wonderful? very, very peaceful. Can hear a white-browed scrub robin calling, a Cape turtle dove. There's a lovely cool breeze blowing at the moment too. Little long-billed crombeck gave a little call now, all in the distance, but wonderful to hear the sounds and see what's going on around us at the moment. So we haven't had any sign of the leopards yet, everyone, but it's still early, so I'm hoping that what we're going to do is we're going to drive around and head back down towards the drainage line and towards Philemon's cut line, which we believe is where the leopards were seen yesterday evening. One vehicle on their way back, I think, managed to spot her very, very quickly. So hopefully we do find her. Not sure where she has gone or where she's disappeared to. Also, we don't know if she's got a kill. And that could be even harder to find, because if she's got a kill, she's possibly taken the cubs there. And it may be well hidden, so not easy to see them or find them. But I'm not sure. Let's see. And the whole time I'm driving, constantly having a lookout for tracks. And we're going to continue. So glad you could enjoy that sunrise with us. And let's head back to James and those little cubs.
Now, we're back again, everybody. This time I did hear it. I do apologize again for my recalcitrance earlier. But here we are. Magnificent, magnificent sighting. I'm just listening to Aubrey at the moment. He's found some leopard tracks. And I'm just going to ask Kirsty to ask Byron to get hold of him on the radio, if you wouldn't mind, Kirsten. Now, unfortunately, Brian, there seems to be some litter here that that little cub has picked up. And it's a piece of piping that was pulled out of the ground by one of the elephants. Byron, sorry, hold on a sec, everybody. Byron, please get hold of Aubrey. He's got leopard tracks for you. Now, that pipe, of course, feeds the Juma Dam pan, or it used to. I think it's a piece of disused piping. Anyway, it won't do any harm. It just looks a bit odd, really. Now, if we look at the back there, amber eyes and the male are awake. Oh, this is my best. It's my best when the cubs go towards the males. Now, which male are we looking at there? Is that Tinyo Nsoko? It's definitely not Mfumo, who's got a hole in his face. Isn't that equal sign across the nose there? It is. Which will change, of course. Now, for those of you who've missed it, our four Birmingham boys, they're named Tinyo, the Tooth, and Suku, the Yellow One, Nana, the Warrior, and Mfumo, the Authority. This is wonderful to see. Now, the male being a lot more tolerant. You can see there the eyes of our favourite lioness, Amber Eyes. That is her, isn't it? And the two little cubs just below us here, trying to suckle. And of course they will all suckle. They will all still be suckling, because they only wean when they're 6 months old. So there will still be a lot of attempts to drink milk. This is rather marvellous, I must say. Hello, Melinda. Interesting update from you, and thank you very much for it, because I think it's quite crucial that information like this gets through to us. You say you saw lions mating on the dam cam, and afterwards they rolled around. And you say, does that mean it was successful? It often does, you know. It often means that the female has that there has been a successful coupling, not to put too fine a point on it. And when she rolls around like that, it generally means that things have done what they're supposed to. So yes, quite possibly. But if this is amber eyes, which I'm pretty sure it is, given the color of her eyes, I'm surprised. Look at him spraying there. I'm surprised that she's still mating, because she's been in a kind of what we call proto-estrus, or estrus before estrus, for so long now. And I would have thought she'd be pregnant by now. And so if she's mating again, I think it's quite interesting. Because the youngster, the very young one, was mating with Mfumo, or he was attempting to mate with her the other day. So that is quite, yeah. I think it's quite a good thing, though, that the two of them are, you know, they put it off for a little while, just in case this mange thing is A, caused by the dryness, and B, continues to infect the pride, because if it does, we don't want new cubs here yet. We want the pride to get over it before we get any new cubs in the area. So I'm not too sad that Amber Eyes is very clearly not pregnant yet. Where the other male is, I don't know. We did hear him calling off to the east earlier this morning. And it's an interesting one from William, and an answer that I'm just not sure that we'll ever be able to completely answer. You say, do I think the males know the difference between their own cubs, their biological cubs, and those that aren't there? So, but would he know the difference between his cubs and his brothers? I'm going to say, I really don't know. We know that, for example, the Matimbas, it was normally the hairy-bellied male, the bigger male, that used to mate with the females, but of course the what would we call the other one again? It was hairy-belly and? Goodness gracious. Anyway, the other one with the red hair.
Blondie.
He was called Blondie. That's Blondie, we didn't see mating, or I certainly didn't, you know, by the time I'd got here. But he played a very affectionate role with the cubs. Now, did he have any idea that they weren't his? Well, he hadn't mated, so I think it's likely that he didn't know. But wouldn't make him any less affectionate. And, of course, he was related, we think, to the hairy belly Matimba. And so, in effect, he is still looking after his own genetic line, albeit not quite as strongly as a lion that has mated. So I'm going to say no, I don't think they know the difference. I think they will look after the cubs within their own pride, and they're not particularly concerned about whether or not they are theirs. I might be entirely wrong, though. Now, I think we're staring down the barrel of a pretty hot day today. Kirsten, what is their weather report? I don't think these lions are going to do a great deal from here. That said, they have been killing buffalo at an alarming rate. If you happen to be a buffalo, that is. And we're looking at 37 degrees Celsius or 99 degrees Fahrenheit, apparently. So it's going to be very hot. And I don't think they're going to move much from here. I think they're going to go down into the drainage line. I think they'll lie in the shade, and that's all they're going to do, unless a buffalo comes wandering past, in which case they will almost certainly kill it. Now, this pride is really, it's He's been amazingly successful. Jeremiah, I've seen lions eat some amazing things. You say, well, what is the strangest thing I've ever seen one eat? Well, I've seen them eat human clothing before. That's quite interesting to watch. I think we had an incident the other day where someone dropped a hat in a lion sighting, and that was devoured and played with, certainly. I think I've seen lions eating other lion dung, which is quite disgusting. But the very strangest thing I've seen, of course, is a lion eating his brother. And his brother died of natural causes, and he then ate him. So that was the strangest thing I've ever seen happen. Something has arrested this cub's attention. I don't know what it is. There was some mating going on there. That's what that noise was. Now, I would have said that was not a successful mating or coupling as they go down into the shade. Let's move around the top here, and then we'll head down into the... see if we couldn't perhaps spot what had arrested that cub's attention. Like a leopard, perhaps. There doesn't seem to be anything. We'll just drive along here and see where those lions are going. And they're all still messing around over there, so let's go back again. Let's go back to where we were. Sorry, everybody. I just thought we might see a different angle. Oh, now, another one. Follow on from William. Do I think the lionesses can tell their own offspring? Yeah, I think they can. Why do I think that? I have no reason to say that, but I'm going to say yes. I think they can probably tell their own offspring. But, you know, they do completely cross-suckle, which means that there's not a huge amount of worry whether they are there or aren't their own cubs. But these guys must know the difference because they're all different sizes. I might be totally wrong, though, William. I'm not sure. It'd be very difficult to tell, I think. Be very difficult to find out if they knew. I'd love to be interesting to kind of design an experiment. So let's pretend you had lions in a laboratory conditions, as we say, and would they be able to tell the difference between their own cubs and their sister's cubs, and how would you be able to tell that? What kind of test could you put in place? Now, why don't you try and come up with an experiment, everybody, a thought experiment. Hashtag Safari Life, question to Wilder.tv. Now, Brian, off there, we've got ground hornbills flying, a huge number of them. Gee whiskers, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Seven. That's really very cool. That's a massive flock. That's high for a ground hornbill. They're not particularly adept flyers. Isn't that wonderful, everybody? That is the great skill of Brian Joubert, the thumb. Very nice, very nice, Brian. They are landing, looks like around Ingwer Alley. Very awkward flying. Marvellous. Yes, now everything seems to have calmed down at the lions. This is not unusual. after an evening of activity. And it's always, you know, it's quite interesting. We've been discussing, Graham and I, the other day about when lions are most active. And we were trying to find kind of a, I mean, you'd think we'd know after all this time out here, but it's really not that easy to figure it out because we don't see them at night a great deal. You know, we pack it up and go home as soon as it gets dark. And from what we can find, it would seem that the most active time for lions, of course, we know straight after sunset they get going and then they hunt for a while, but also just before dawn, just before the sun comes up, probably for about an hour and a half to 2 hours. They call if they're being territorial, they hunt if they're hungry, and they play if they're youngsters. And you can see as the sun came up here, they all calmed down. So for about half an hour before you came live, I suspect they were moving between Arethusa and exactly where they are now. And as that sun popped over the horizon, things have calmed down completely. And I think there's going to be a substantial amount of slumber going on here. It is the weekend, though, after all, Brian. We don't want them to sort of stress themselves out. Shall we try and drive down the spillway here and see if we can't get a shot? The sand might be quite soft, but I think it's probably hardened enough in the sun over the last few days. Now, Whitney, you're saying if they wouldn't take in an orphaned cub, surely they must know their own cubs. Whitney, I think that they certainly know the cubs from the pride, but do they know their own cubs? So do they know their own cubs from their sisters' cubs? I'm not convinced that they do. Absolutely, they know the cubs in the pride, for sure. We're now eye level with this little mangy fellow. Yeah, and mind warp, you make a very good point. You say you reckon they probably could tell the cubs apart because they did spend a month alone with them, and so they must have some kind of familial smell. Yeah, I think that's logical. And certainly that would be, to me, the obvious way for them to be told by their mothers, by some kind of smell. Poor little things, still scratching away at his mange. Oh, it's not ideal, really. The time will tell. They're eating plenty, so they have the best possible chance of getting over this disease. Shamrock, haven't heard from you for a while. Wonderful to hear from you. It's obviously Saturday, so I know you used to watch this show at work, which of course was an excellent idea. Shamrock, a question that I do not know the answer to, I'm afraid. I'm not insufficiently medically trained. But you say, is it possible that if an adult got over the disease and had the antibodies to fight it off, would they pass that on to their cubs? I imagine that they would, you know. I really don't know for sure, but I imagine that the presence of the antibodies in the mother's blood must surely get into the fetus. This thing does not look healthy, does it, Brian? It's looking, well, mangy and also breathing unevenly, but that's because its belly is so full of buffalo. And that, of course, is going to be its best defense against the mange. Good meals. Home-cooked meals, care from the pride, and a healthy dose of luck. Right, let's go and find out if Byron has managed to find any tracks of the Queen. In the meantime, I'm going to sit here for a little while longer, and then once everything settles down, we'll go and find something else.
So we don't have tracks of the leopard yet. We've had a look around. One of the other guides did say he saw tracks of what appeared to be Karula and her two cubs, but they've headed, sounds like southwest and possibly across our boundary, unfortunately. But I'm heading into that area just to double check. Maybe she is still hanging around in a block somewhere. We're not far from the main road now. So let's have a look and just see. It's very difficult unless you've got time to get onto fresh tracks and walk and track carefully. To follow a leopard it's not easy. You know, you could get lucky and bump into them walking around, but ideally the best way to find these animals is to get the fresh tracks, start walking on them and follow, and then hopefully find out where they are. Times like this, I wish I had my friend Judas with me. And Judas is a tracker, he's been tracking for 30 years. And him and I would find many, many leopards purely because of his tracking skills. He really had a sixth sense about the bush. So I also just want to scan very carefully while we're driving around. I'm going to drive quite slowly along this main road. Did you see some tracks? Hang on, yeah, there we go. Yeah, there are tracks right here. Okay, everyone, let me just have a look. Here are some tracks. Stay with me for a second. Let me just, let me try to see if I can find some tracks to show you that are clear. The nice thing about leopards occasionally is they do like to walk along the roads because it's a large pathway that makes it easy for them to move around. Okay, so I saw tracks coming there. Okay, everyone, here's this beautiful leopard track right here. And heading in this direction, so heading away from, but let me just have a look. Oh, this is interesting. Everyone, this looks very interesting. This is not Karula. This is a male leopard that has walked here. It looks like to me the track is much, much larger than a female track, and also it's by itself. I don't see, there are no tracks of cubs or anything here. So this is a male leopard that's moved through this area this morning sometime. The tracks do look good. Is this some Bambili or is this Arethusa? Actually not sure. I'll have to try to find out quickly and just have a look. But that is the thing with these big male leopards, is they cover huge distances very, very quickly, and especially in the evenings or early mornings, they can move very, very far. I think what I'm going to do, everyone, is I'm just going to drive down this road a little bit and just see if we can work out where these tracks go. Maybe we're lucky, who knows? They have been walking all the way down the road, and Dave might even be able to see the tracks on that side of the road. You can still see them there. Yep. So let's have a look. See, it looks like they're still going that way. Isn't this exciting? This is just what I was talking about, to be able to find fresh leopard tracks and see which direction they go. Wendy, you wanted to know, are clouded leopards in the same family as the leopards here in Africa? And Wendy, they are. They're also part of the Panthera family. And they are leopard species, but obviously a subspecies, a different species of leopard. But they are indeed. Scanning, looking very, very carefully here. But as I said, you know, a leopard like this that's moving around, marking territory, could possibly be quite far already. Can you still see tracks there, Dave? All right, let me just jump off here again, everyone. See, the whole time while we're tracking, also we've got to scan very, very carefully because there could be something in the bushes around here. I'm just going to have a look back here again. I don't see any tracks going that way. This is interesting, everyone. These tracks seem to have disappeared on us for a brief moment, and that's what happens. Occasionally, these leopards cross into these blocks, and a block, we call it a block, it's an area of bush that is between the roads. So it could possibly be that he's moved through there. Maybe he was hunting. That could be one of the reasons. He saw something and decided to try and look for cover and move through the thickets. I'm going to check back here, Dave, I think. All right, everyone, we're going to have a good look around here. Just make sure we know, or just try to find out which direction that leopard's gone. It is exciting, but while I do that, let's head back to James and see what the lions are up to.
The lions are doing very little, everybody, and so we're going to just spend another 5 or 10 minutes with them, and then we're going to head off and see what else this Guy Fawkes Day has to offer us. I've forgotten about that. Do you remember that, Brian?
I do.
It's Guy Fawkes.
Oh, completely forgot.
Yes, the day Mr. Guy Fawkes tried to explode the Parliament. Yes. I think of, King Charles II?
I'm not too sure.
One of the royal Stuarts, of course, and apparently a complete imbecile. Which is sad, because he was a Scottish king. It's also Scott Dyson's birthday, which is, for those of you who remember Scott, you'll join us in wishing him a happy, happy Safari Live birthday. He's in Kenya and he's guiding at the moment, which will make him very happy. It's absolute peace now. We've got doves calling in the background. Jim, you say the loud birds, I think they're the doves I've just mentioned. They're going poop, 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 poop. It is the ring-necked dove, or the Cape turtle dove it used to be known as. Oh, deeply fatigued. We're going to do one, let me go a little bit forward and we can have one last eye-level view. And then I think we're into the law of diminishing returns, as they say. And by that I just mean that I think we've got to the point at which, well, you know, staying here is not going to enhance our impression of these lions. And if you do hear what sounds like the dim crackle of rifle fire, fear not, we're not under attack. It is that the photographic vehicle in front of us is firing off on auto motor drive. I do feel a little intimidated when I see that vehicle, Brian.
Me too.
No, now. Something's up. What are they looking at? Well, like I said, there was a male calling behind earlier this morning. I don't think that's what's going on here. Maybe it's an impala or something that's thinking about coming down for a drink. Might be a buffalo thinking about coming down for a drink. In which case, if Taylor was here, these lions would almost certainly kill it within seconds. Beautiful, beautiful morning. Soon to turn into a deeply hot day. Kristen, I think people often wonder about this, especially in winter when it's cold, and especially when you see little cubs. You say, is the lion's hair rough or smooth? It's smoothish. I haven't felt a cub's hair. I've felt an adult lion who had recently shaken off this mortal coil. I felt her hair, and it's... I'm trying to think where I felt it. It's actually, you know what it feels like? I don't know if you felt a horse with a summer coat on, to a big animal like that. It feels very similar to that. So completely unlike a sort of a cat's hair or a dog's hair. I suppose a very short-haired dog. Yeah, like a staffy or something like that. Hair feels very similar to that. It's not any harder than that. I've always wanted to feel the belly hair of a leopard, though. That always looks like softest possible hair. But of course, to lay your head onto the belly of a big wild cat is to invite, well, I'd say a couple of scars to the face, wouldn't you, Brian? Yes. So, no, I've never felt it. But it would be quite something. There's another dove calling very gently, also called a laughing dove. What's he looking at? I don't know what this cub's looking at. Now, we had some incident this morning where the lions were running all around the car. They were getting quite nervous of the male who was chasing them. And Wendy, you're wondering if I ever have the temptation to reach out and touch one as they go past the car. Yes, funnily enough, I have had that sort of feeling before of wanting to reach out. It's a little bit like vertigo, where, you know, if you get vertigo, you feel like you should throw yourself off a high cliff, or you feel like jumping when you know you shouldn't. And that is a little bit like the feeling you get when a lion comes close by. You want to stick your hand out and say hi. But the temptation has never been that strong. It has, however, Wendy, been very strong when we go past buffalo. And the temptation to slap one on the backside as you go past is overwhelming. Now, for some reason, up here in the north, we don't seem to get close enough to the buffalo to do that. But down south at Londolozi one day, we were driving along, and it wasn't only me that felt this temptation, clearly. Johnson, a substantial tracker, was sitting on the front, and we were driving through a herd of buffalo, and I was telling the guests about something or other, and I heard this mighty thwack. And Johnson had slapped one of the buffalo on the backside, and he thought it was hilarious. The buffalo didn't know what had hit her, and she went trotting off into the herd, sort of with a grunt and a burp, and Johnson was paralytic with laughter for most of the rest of the drive. But I absolutely have that temptation. But Wendy, you mustn't go slapping wild animals, please. It's not a good idea. All right, everyone, I think we're going to press on from here, don't you, Brian?
Mm.
We'll come back a little bit later and see what's going on, see if they haven't killed a buffalo or two. And if any buffalo come anywhere near the Juma Dam cam, everybody, just keep an eye on it, because it will be worth coming back to see what these cubs do. Before we move out, Anne, you've noticed why that the soil here is very pale. and you want to know why that is the case. And it's granite based. Normally when it's white like this, there's a lot of sodium in the soil. That's what causes a lot of the sodic areas, and the sodic areas are caused by sodium ions, if you like. I don't know if how much you remember of your high school chemistry, but basically sodium in solution. So if you put salt in water and mix it up, it goes into solution, and that's what happens down the slope. So when rain falls on the soil, it puts the sodium into solution, and that what it does is it creates a situation where the clay doesn't stick together anymore, and if you want to know the term for that, it's called flocculate. And the clay then comes sliding slowly over the years down the slope. So at the top of the slope you get sand, with the sandy marula crest, and as you get towards the drainage lines, which is what we're on now, you get a situation where all the clay and all of the sodium builds up over hundreds of years. It's moved under the action of gravity and water into these areas. And that's why if you get close by to the big drainage lines here, the soil tends to be a lot paler, a lot whiter. There's a lot more sodium in it. You get things like quarry bushes, huge quarry thickets. You get some of the red thorn trees, the acacias. You get jacket plums, and you get a very specific suite or set of grasses that like to grow in the soil. But that's why, in a long-winded way, the soil is paler than it might be. Right, Brian, I'm about to fall asleep. Let's carry on. These lions are so soporific. In the meantime, let's head across to Byron, get an update from him. I'm going to head off towards Beefles Hook Dam.
So unfortunately, still no sign of the leopard, and those tracks cut off into quite a thick area. But what I've done is I've looped around to see if we can't see tracks coming out, which is usually what happens. But I don't see anything. We may have missed the track somewhere. Let's have a good look around here. When you get to these junctions in roads, it's a good spot to have a look for leopard tracks, or any tracks for that matter. We haven't had any luck. I was chatting to Dave, and it's a bit difficult for us because obviously we can't get off and go and track for half an hour and leave you alone. So it is hard for us to be able to track the animals, because you do have to be very, very careful when tracking animals. You've got to spend a lot of time searching very carefully. And you know what? I'm still, and I think James shares this opinion with me, in that for us to drive around and try to track and find animals, it's incredibly difficult. And I doubt there are people that can do it very, very well, unless you have been a tracker before, perhaps. Because I do think we probably miss out on so much. There's nothing there. These brakes are squeaking this morning, waking us up. MC Chef, I believe, was the who sent in the question. You want to know, how is it that we keep the roads clear or clean? So there is road maintenance that goes on, and what they do occasionally is they drag, the tractors will come out and they'll maintain the roads. And what they do, they've got this contraption with, it's basically tires, which they just drag behind the vehicle, and behind the tractor. And as they drag it, it just smooths the roads out a little bit. And that's done every now and then, especially after the rains, just to maintain the roads, excuse me, and that we don't get soil erosion or erosion off the road. So there is maintenance that happens on the roads, but we don't actually do it. It's usually the landowners that do it. So no luck just yet, everyone, but that's how it goes sometimes. You can track and look for leopards and try and find them and track for hours and not find anything. And then all of a sudden you come around a corner and there's a leopard in the road. It happens like that regularly. I'll never forget, on a number of occasions I've been tracking, looking for animals, and we end up tracking for 2 hours and literally don't even find impala, never mind anything else. And the bush can happen like that. You have these times where you're searching, you're looking very, very carefully, but it just doesn't go your way. But then later, the bush kind of pays back and you do find stuff. Morning, everyone. Morning. And I do think patience and perseverance in the bush pays off. A lot of impala through the, basically in the distance, you can just see these little brown dots in between the trees. There's some off to our left, a little bit closer over here. The sun's getting quite bright now. Saw something interesting in it. There's some buffalo tracks around. And what did I see here? Oh. Let me show you something, everybody. I just quickly want to show you little tracks before we head back to James. Can you see these little tracks off to the side here, Dave? Yeah. Yeah, those ones. Oh, great. Let me just show you this quickly, everyone. So we are tracking, obviously, leopards or whatever we can find. But look at these beautiful little tracks over here that we've just seen. And this is actually from an African civet that has probably been moving around during the course of the evening. Moved all the way along the road. And I say during the evening because they are nocturnal. So this is from an African civet that has walked through here. Some people think they're part of the cat family. They're not. They're not cats at all. They're in their own family. I think they're part of Viverridae, if I'm not mistaken. I think Viverridae, I'll double check later. But while we continue tracking and having a look around, let's head to James. He's got something really long, tall, and beautiful that he'd like to show you.
Gone. There it goes. You might just be able to see a little shadow walking through there. Unfortunately, Byron wanted to show you the civet track, so I'm afraid the beautiful giraffe we had for you is now no longer visible. I do apologize for that. Right, on we go, Brian. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Lost my lens cap, everybody. Something of a disaster. I lose it at least 6 times a day. I'm sure I'll find it again. Hello, Earl. You're wondering about the long-term future of the Sabi sand and whether it will become like the Dill.
Bill,
as in William.
As William.
Right. Bill, sorry, not Earl. You say, will it become like the Sahara Desert eventually? Here comes this giraffe. Bill, I don't believe it will ever become like the Sahara Desert. Will it change? Absolutely. Under what action will it change? I don't know. So let's pretend that human beings got a virus that wiped us all out within, say, 10 years. And there wasn't a human being left in this area. Then what would it look like?
in the long term, so after 1,000 years or so, or 200 years. I think what you'd find is that it would open up. I think the number of elephants would grow. I think there would be a huge amount of movement of animals to and from the mountains. I think the old migration patterns would reassert themselves, and I think it would open up. I don't believe that it would ever become a desert without some major climatic change. And climatic change, Bill, would only come about through, well, because I've chased all the humans away with a virus. It would be some kind of a geologic or seismic climatic change, the same as which, like an ice age, for example, because the Sahara Desert, of course, used to be a sea. It used to be a very fertile area up until about 15,000 years ago. That was perfect timing from that hornbill, wasn't it, Brian? So I think, if climate stayed relatively stable, the place wouldn't change much. The number of animals, I think, would increase. The number of species would increase because the artificial water would be taken away. So that's what would happen here. In the actual long term, of course, I'm going to go forward. I think there's something else in the bush here. In the actual long term, Bill, I think what you'll find is that humans, of course, are not going to go anywhere from the area. And so we will continue to put artificial water into the place, but I think to try and predict the future with humans involved is almost impossible. I think for the foreseeable future it will look very much like it does now, but that's a very interesting question. There are some elephants, Brian, that's what I heard crashing through the bushes, a great bevy of elephants. Do you see them, Brian? Is this an acceptable position, or should I go forward? We'll do for now. A beautiful herd of elephants, enjoying their breakfast, which is the same meal as they had for lunch, and supper, and tea, and midnight snack last night. Leaves. Now, she's got a very classically square skull. It's very typical of an elephant cow. You'll not see an elephant bull with a skull that square. That's really quite interesting to see. They always tell you that, of course, you can tell the difference between a bull and a cow from the roundness or squareness of the forehead, but often it's not as clear cut as that. She's obviously got quite a large frontal cortex, I imagine. So she's probably quite clever. Yew, it's going to be hot today. I can just feel the first effects of the sun coming up now. We're going to batten down the hatches as soon as breakfast is over. I think we'll all pile into the final control and huddle under the air conditioner. Kirsten will probably chase us out there. Here comes a young bull towards us. It's not a young bull at all, is it, Brian?
No.
Because a much easier way of telling is what Brian's showing you now. Very clear mammary glands that give them really almost disturbingly humanoid feature, I find. It always reminds me how very much like us they are. Not in physically, of course, they're quite a lot bigger than us, Brian. I've met one or two people the size of an elephant, but very few. And I always just find, oh, here she comes, that their behavior, the way they behave, is almost predictable from a human point of view. They're very defensive of their youngsters. The young bulls behave just like teenage boys. The young cows behave just like teenage girls. The babies behave just like human children in a creche. There are a whole lot coming now. What she's doing is just making sure that everyone who comes across the road is safe. She's stopped to check us out. Now she's indicated to the others that it's fine for them to come across the road. this little one, just with its tusks erupting, probably almost 2 years old. It's not Benji, is it? No. You can see the light burnt out already, and it's not yet 7 o'clock in the morning. Everyone, I would move forward so that you can get sort of slightly less into the light, but I'm afraid there are now elephants all sides of us, so we're going to stay right here. Here comes the first cow we saw with a very square head, with her little youngster. And they're just talking to each other. That, I just must reiterate, is not what it sounds like to them. There are frequencies that we don't hear, and our little larynxes are completely unable to make. So although it might sound like you're talking to an elephant when you go, the elephant just thinks you're being an idiot. I think that's a bull, Brian.
Yes.
From the rounded head.
Yes. And the length of his tail.
The length of his tail, yes.
Yes.
Good. There's another cow to the left, Brian, who's checking us out there. Hello, Matthew. Another lovely question that I'm afraid I don't know the answer to. Do elephants ever bite their tongues, you say? I'm trying to think of the shape of an elephant's tongue. You know, I think an elephant's tongue doesn't stick out like ours does, Matthew. Now, she's not too happy with us. She's just saying, stay right there. Opened her ears out, not particularly pleased to see us. She's not the oldest cow, and so perhaps she's just a little bit inexperienced. Can you see how predictable that is, everyone? It's just like a human being walking, you know, coming across someone they don't know and kind of standing up dead straight, posturing, going stiff. It's exactly the same kind of thing. Matthew, I'm going to say I don't think they bite their tongues. So you bite your tongue probably sometimes, like I bite mine, and Brian every self bites his, don't you, Brian?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a horrible feeling.
It's terrible.
But it's because we have a long tongue and we move it around a lot in our mouths, and we have to be able to move it around in our mouths to speak. And so it's an adaptation to being able to speak, I think, that gives us this long floppy tongue that sits in between our teeth. Whereas an elephant's tongue is much shorter and sits in the mouth in between the teeth, and I don't think they bite them. I imagine a giraffe probably bites its long tongue every so often. Good. Right, well, I'm going to sneak slightly forward. Most of the elephants have gone across the road. Yeah, there goes a tree. Oh dear. The tree just bit the dust there, everybody. Deborah, armchair traveller. We were talking about the shapes of male and female heads earlier. And that cow there, you can see, has got a squarish head, but not as square as the first one we saw. And you want to know why it is that they should have different foreheads. Why are the males round? Why are the females square? I don't know. I'm going to guess, okay? There are two possibilities, and I think the first one is more likely. I think that the males are probably adapted like that to bashing their heads against each other. So I think you'll probably find that the rounder shape minimizes the injury. There's probably a thicker covering of sort of absorptive material on the top of the skull, and that probably allows them to, you know, I mean, they do fight quite angrily sometimes, and I think that probably protects the brain. The second possible reason, I suppose, could be that the females do actually have a slightly different brain structure, and that is possible, and maybe the brain structure allows them they're far greater sociality. They certainly apparently have a far greater range of vocal communication skills than the males do. That again is very similar to our human species, where males speak to each other in grunts and signals, and women have conversations. Not so, Brian.
Very true, James.
It has actually been proven that I think, and this was a while back, so it's probably changed by now, but male elephants make, I think they make something like, say, well, it's roughly 20 sounds, only three of which are unique to bull elephants. Female elephants make about 40 sounds, say, and 28 or so of those are unique to the females. So they're much more communicative. Right, from this elephant's bottom, we're going to go to Buffleshook Dam and let's head across to Byron, another bee, and he's got a nyala.
We have indeed got an nyala. I've got a baby nyala, everyone. Look at this little, beautiful little nyala. She's just hiding behind some branches there a little bit. Hang on. Let me see if I can move forward. Oh. There we go. Look at that. The whole big group here. There's a lot of females, but then this little nyala. Oh, look at that. There's some adults behind it. There's a big female. Really are wandering through the bush at the moment, trying to hide from us. Even though it's not that thick here, but there are lots of little sticks in our way. Very, very peaceful. There's some impala in the distance, in the background. Probably won't be able to see them, but a lot of nyala around. Look at that beautiful bushy tail on that female. And you can see the white stripes very clearly on the body. There was a young male. He was, I'm not sure where he has gone now. I think he's just off to the left there. It's just through the, a little bit to the right, Dave, I think. There he is. He's just through there. There we go. Bit tricky, but you can see he is slightly darker. He's going through that transition phase, where he's going to be changing the coat or his coloration. It will go much, much darker gray as opposed to this reddish brown of the females. I just want to see if I can't get another view of them quickly. It's because they are so beautiful. Hang on, everyone. And you can see the difference. Oh, there we go. There's the male. See, it's a young male. He will still get bigger and he will still get darker. But look at the difference between him and those females. Amazing. Those females with that beautiful reddish-brown coloration. It was nice to see that young nyala. Very, very special. And then they've just moved off again. Anyway, when I left you earlier, we saw tracks of a civet. And I'm sure some of you might be thinking, what does a civet look like? So let me just show you quickly. I've got my book out, and that is the African civet. Looks almost badger-like, mixed with a cat a little bit, but as I said, they're in a different family completely. They are in the family called Viverridae, and the civets and the genets, these little creatures. Let me just show you quickly. These little creatures, the little genets, which are also nocturnal, also appear cat-like, but they are not part of the cat family at all. All in the Viverridae family. So it's a separate family completely. Interesting. So we saw tracks of the civet. We didn't find the civet, unfortunately. But they are mainly nocturnal, so probably moving around during the course of the evening. And We have had no sign of any predators yet. Not on my side. James was the lucky one this morning with the lions. But it's still early. It's still very early. It's only about 6:15 our time. So it's still early. And we could still get animals moving around. Shannon, you want to know why the males are darker than the females. I have no idea, Shannon. I don't know if there's a specific reason, other than it's just the sexual dimorphism between the male and female in Yala. I don't know if there's a specific reason for it. And if anybody else has heard a theory or has a theory on it, I'd be very interested to know. But it's, I just think that, you know, with all these antelope species, the males tend to be a bit bigger and generally have bigger horns. They look more impressive than the females, and all of that is to attract the females. So I think it's purely from an attraction point of view for those males when they display too. You know, we spoke about it the other day, and James and I did our Inyala dances. But the males, what they do is they cause that hair on their back to stand up, and they do this beautiful dance and display to basically intimidate one another and then to attract a female. So I think that would be the only reason. I don't know of any other reason, Shannon. Safari Dean, you'd like me to find some cheetah chop chop. Well, that would be wonderful. I wish it was that easy. Okay, we need to find something interesting now. It's time, so let's see. Keep your eyes peeled, Dave. A lot of birds around, a lot of doves, and there was some starlings flying around. Lovely to see all the bird life here. I've really enjoyed the birding over the last 2 weeks. Still got another week of safari life, which is great. I'm here till next week Wednesday, and then a short break, only a little, about a week break. And after that, hang on. Oh, these brakes. Seen an interesting bird, everyone. Let's just have a look. Just on the water's edge there. Can you see it there? It's just walked away from the water. Ah, what is this? I've got a feeling it's a sandpiper. I'm just going to look with my binoculars. It is indeed a wood sandpiper, everyone. Very beautiful bird. And have a look. Look at this interesting behavior. It bobs its tail up and down. Often it'll stand. And you see that? There we go. Doing a little dance. Maybe James and I will have to do a wood sandpiper dance-off. See if we can move like that. I doubt James will be very happy with me suggesting it. I've got a feeling he'd be quite good at it. I think because... Anyway. So that's a nice bird to see, a different bird species, a wood sandpiper. And it's interesting that it's around this little mud wallow. Most likely a lot of insects that it is feeding on. It's a perfect little spot. Look how it's wading through there. Look, that's beautiful reflection. Look at that. Wow. Get some lovely photographs now. A And there's some Cape turtle doves calling in the distance. Work harder, work harder. And I'm trying to work harder to find a leopard this morning. But it is also just so wonderful to experience every little bit of nature. It doesn't matter, from these little birds to the antelope. And things happen when you start appreciating the smaller things. I do think it's very, very important that you enjoy every facet of nature, not just the big cats or the elephant or the buffalo. There's so much out here. And I constantly see things that I've never seen before, little insects, and still see a bird species now and then that I haven't seen before. Melinda, you asked why some of the bird species, or quite a few bird species, bob their heads while they're walking. And I don't know. I really don't know if there's a specific reason. It's an interesting question, Melinda. I'm not sure. I've never read anything on that. And again, I also think, you know, is there a correct answer for that? Or are there just theories? Because how do we really know? What is the reason the sandpiper walks around and bobs its tail? What is the reason another bird walks around and bobs its head? I'm not sure. Other than maybe it helps them move, or it's part of their movement while they're walking. I have absolutely no idea. Don, you're saying something interesting. You think that it's for them to gauge or see distance because their eyes are on the side of their heads. But I wonder, how does that, I'm trying to work it out, how does that help them then? It's interesting. I've no idea. But Don, that's a very interesting answer, and it sounds plausible. But I just don't understand how bobbing the head would help see the distance, other than, yeah, I don't know. You've stumped me this morning. I don't know. Perhaps we can ask James. I'm not sure if he knows. We'll ask him shortly. This is the area that Karula was in yesterday morning. We saw her tracks around here, and I think somebody from a neighboring property found her just south of this spot. And then apparently they walked across again, but they have crossed out of our territory, or our little concession. It happens. These animals like leopards, and that have very large territories every once. And when they are walking around or patrolling them, they can cover huge distances in one evening. And even for a female who's got between a 5 or 10k territory, the radius of territory, that's more than, you know, that's quite a large part of Juma. So she'd definitely move through very quickly to get onto the neighboring property where the rest of her territory is. Matthew, speaking about territories, you want to know, are the territories, or do some animals' territories overlap? They definitely overlap in certain areas. And even with leopards, there'll be areas. Now, they do defend their territories. and they get quite aggressive if they bump into other leopards within their territory. But they will definitely overlap slightly. So if you've got two territories, you'll have one or two that overlap slightly. And usually it'll be around water holes because they need water. So sorry, I've just seen something here, everyone, but these look like lion tracks. I think looks like there's some more on that side. Is it? Yeah, so lion tracks. Just want to double check. Yeah, looks like lioness tracks from last night sometime. I'm curious. So Matthew, so the territories do overlap slightly, and especially at waterholes because they need to share the waterholes, but they do defend them against one another. That's just for leopard. Then if you have lion prides, their territories overlap definitely. Some of the other species of animals like the elephant and that, they're not territorial, so they'll move all over. Some of the antelope species that are territorial, they may defend their territories, but they'll be very close to others and their territories could also overlap. But I would say the territorial animals that we would think of and that defend their territories and don't want other animals coming in would be lion and leopard, for example. They would defend it, they would look after that territory, and because success for a lot of these animals is having a big territory. So those animals do defend them, but they will definitely overlap in certain areas. Some hyena tracks, everyone. Now, we've seen the hyena tracks, we just haven't seen a hyena for a very long time. But there are, almost daily, there are hyena tracks around on the roads. But still no sign of them. I think because of all the lions around, it's possibly keeping the hyena off Juma at the moment, for the moment. But I'm sure at some point they'll come through again. Anyway, let's head back to James, get an update from him, see what he is up to. And maybe he's got an answer for you on that, why birds bob their heads.
We're trying to find some European bee-eaters. There you go. Of course, the ultimate skill of Brian Jubert and his thumb doing an excellent job. And they're like little fighter planes. Very difficult to follow. And that's why you're staring at blue sky at the moment. But there we'll get you another one. You see the way their wings are designed. And they've got these amazing forked tails that they can use to grab insects out of the air. So they're picking up insects with those sharp beaks from the air. And they look like little fighter jets to me. Isn't that nice? There one goes into the sun. That's gorgeous, Brian. Gorgeous. They're heading towards Beefles Hook Dam, maybe, which is where we're going to go. Now, while we watch that bird, that is an astounding picture of a bird in flight. Isn't that gorgeous? Gee whiz. Wow. What was the question? Byron said he was going to ask me something or something. I didn't quite get it. Oh, I think I've been asked the same thing before and I don't think I was able to answer it. You say, why do birds bob their heads while they walk? I think birds bob their heads while they walk for the same reason that a giraffe moves its head when it walks and a horse moves its head when it walks. They've got longer necks, more vertebrae in the neck, or not more vertebrae in the neck, but longer vertebrae. And it's just every time they move, then their heads move. But except a bird stops dead still and goes and wags its tail. I don't know, I'm afraid. Maybe it's got something to do with judging distance. Ah, I've just got confirmation there from Kirsten that one of you agrees with me that it is to do with trying to judge distance. So we know that a monkey, for example, will look like this to try and pick out the exact distance, and birds will do the same. If they're sitting in trees, they will often turn their, move their heads like that just to pick up distance, because it moves the head slightly. I think that's probably exactly what it is, because it moves the head slightly, which means it changes the focal distance, and so it gives you a better 3D perception. And of course, if you're a bird that is picking things off the ground, small things, or picking things out of water, I think maybe it really does help to bob the head just to get a better binocular perspective. Good. Let's go with that. We'll decide that that is exactly what the answer is. And no one will tell us otherwise, will they, Brian? Nope. Right, we are approaching Beefleshoek Dam now. Are you ready, everybody? Put on your snorkels and your flippers and your diving equipment. Have you been diving, Brian?
I have.
Did you enjoy it?
I did. I've even done a shark dive.
Brian.
I know.
It's very brave of you. Brian's done a shark dive, everybody.
It was really exciting.
But I mean, you are bigger than most sharks, so I'm sure they were quite afraid of you. Here we are at the dam. Dustin, I will answer your question now, or Justin. I'm afraid the comms are not good enough for me to hear which it is. Ah, Dustin with a D. You're wondering, when we get back to camp, do the cameramen talk non-stop, because they don't talk much on the drives? You find, Dustin, that the cameramen are not generally that vociferous. Brian says a few things when we get home. David hasn't spoken since he was 4 years old. VM speaks sometimes, but we're not sure what language it is. Gendre does. Gendre yaks away quite a lot when we get back to camp. And Eggsy, a bit like David. He's sort of a mixture between David and VM. He sometimes speaks, but completely incomprehensibly. Would you say that's accurate, Brian?
Yeah, 100%.
I'd say. What you got to watch out for, though, when you get back to camp, Dustin, is the directors. Gosh, they can yak the hind leg off a donkey. So there, of course, is, I'm being facetious and nasty, they don't talk too much at all. There is the Bachelor of Biffleshoek, Bob, and there's another wood sandpiper. Just to the left and down, Brian. It's a wood sandpiper bobbing its head, judging distance. It's in the... We've got it there.
What a dove.
No, it's closer to us, closer to the shore. It's in the middle of the water. Not close to the shore at all. In the water about, say, 20 metres in from the closest part of the shore to us. Okay. You got it. Yeah. Well spotted. Now, I think that is a wood sandpiper. It is, indeed. And this, of course, was where I found a wood sandpiper last year, and I was helped in my identification thereof by some ornithological viewers. Picking out little invertebrates and things from... Well, it must be elephant dung. Floating elephant dung. Marvellous. I'm glad we don't have to fish our breakfast out of floating elephant dung. And up above us, you can hear the sound of the red-billed buffalo weaver as they... Well, it's now breeding season for them, of course. Very exciting time. They've been building their nests non-stop. And now they can lay some eggs in them and raise some more baby red-billed buffalo weavers. Which, of course, reminds me, Brian, of the tragic tale of Buffy. The red-billed buffalo weaver. I'm not sure anybody, if you remember Samuel Chevalier, who joined us for a little while, and he found a buffalo weaver that had been turfed out of its nest or had fallen, and we tried to put it back, but we couldn't make the thing climb in. And he seemed to have had some kind of a stroke or epileptic problem. And the left side of his body was almost crippled. And, you know, we tried to feed him and did our best to keep the little fellow alive. But eventually he went off to Buffalo Weaver Heaven. And Samuel gave him a very moving eulogy, which you will probably still find on our Facebook page. And if you are feeling down at all and you feel like a good laugh, please don't take it seriously. It really is a piece of masterful comic timing, I feel, from old Samuel Chevalier. The eulogy of Buffy the Buffalo Weaver. Now, I've heard that Byron is coming to say hello to us here, but he's taking a very long time over it, so I think it's probably time that we pressed on. Oh, I can hear him approaching now. I wonder what great gem of wisdom he's going to share with us. What do you think, Brian?
Maybe a cooking recipe?
A cooking recipe?
Yeah.
That will be very nice, a delicious cooking recipe. Do you think it is for Portuguese chicken wings?
Most likely.
Most likely Portuguese chicken wings. Alternatively, homemade peri-peri sauce.
Mm.
Oh, there's a big bird there. Hang on. We can look at that while we wait for him to get here. There's a very large bird in that tree over there. Diane, I'm going to decline your very kind offer that Byron and I should do a competition to emulate the bobbing head of the wood sandpiper. Diane, I don't think anybody should be subjected to that. I've no idea what that is. It looks like a... goodness. It's got a little bit of that... it's got a little bit of that head crown, so it's quite possibly a Wahlberg's. But it's on its own, and I think it looks a bit big. So I'm not sure. Anyway, we'll try and find out. Here comes Byron, everyone, with David, the silent one. Byron, I've been waiting here for you for hours. What do you want?
Morning, James. Morning, Brian.
Hello, Byron.
Lovely to
Hello,
see you.
Hello, Dave.
Hello.
David spoke, everyone.
I've been struggling to find
anything.
Fresh signs of leopard.
Yes.
So, we had a request about either doing a Nyala dance-off or a wood sandpiper dance-off.
And you want to do this, do you?
I feel we should. Which one would you like to do?
Which one would you like to do?
Which one do you want to do?
I think the sandpiper's a goodie.
I think we've done Nyala dance to death myself,
sandpiper.
So I think maybe sandpiper bobbing. Right, I will now do a sandpiper bobbing dance, I suppose.
Sandpiper bob off.
I truly think this is the worst idea anyone's ever had, but we're going to try it anyway.
How do you...
Is that your sandpiper bobble?
No.
Okay, you go first.
Round one, fight!
Yeah!
Holy moly.
I think that's very impressive. I'm not sure that I can compete. Right, good. Byron wins. Let's go.
Advantage is that he wasn't
born with hips that stick out, aka the bubble butt, which I have.
There we go.
Now go and find some animals.
Let's go and find animals.
Well done, everyone.
So embarrassing. So embarrassing. Goodbye, Byron.
Goodbye, James.
Goodbye, David.
Goodbye, James.
Bye, Byron. Bye, Dave.
Which way are you going?
I'm going to go down, check the drainage line.
I'll go this way.
Franklin alarm calling around here. Have a look.
Okay, I'll do that. Aaron says it was a Franklin alarm calling around here. I hope you all liked your Saturday morning wood sandpiper bob-off. I have to say that I had no idea what to do there, and so that's why I made Byron go first. So I was sort of trying to emulate him. Don't tell him that. Please. I think we're going to go and do another little southern boundary patrol and just see if we can't find some more sign of Kurula. I don't believe her to have gone south of the reserve. In the meantime, let us head across to Byron, get an update from him, tell him, of course, please tell him that he hopelessly lost that competition, just for the sake of it, even if you don't really think that happened.
So, fun and games over. Let's start finding some animals, everyone. that was quite funny. I hope you enjoyed it. That was fun. I'm having a look along these drainage lines now. It is starting to warm up quite a bit. I'm hoping we get some movement from something, anything interesting. An Egyptian geese that's not very happy. It just flew off. Can hear a lot of birds calling. There was a red-chested cuckoo calling. And but to find them is very, very difficult. Come on, there's some nice soft sand around here, so I'm hoping if we do see any signs of some leopard tracks, because I do believe that there's a lot more leopard around here than that we actually see, but they are so elusive, and if they don't want to be seen, they're not going to be seen. I mean, those tracks that we had this morning were definitely of a male. They were big, and then Aubrey said he saw tracks of Karula and her cubs moving through Juma, but through and then out again. So there's a lot of leopard activity around, but I think that what happens is they move around a lot at night, and when it's much cooler, you know, the heat at the moment, getting into the heat of the day, it's not very pleasant for these big cats to move around, however they do. And we've seen it with the Nkuhumas, with the lions. They have been very successful in hunting in the afternoons. Two or three times in the last week, they've gone off and hunted middle of the afternoon, which is incredible. Understand everyone is just still laughing about the dance off. Oh, what was that little guy? I saw something move on this tree, everyone. I'm not sure if it was a tree agama. Looked like it, but so moved so quickly. I just caught a glimpse of the tail moving around the back of the tree, but they are shy, and then they go and they hide from you. It looks like it's gone. And these little tree agamas, they're lizards. They sit on the trees. They get these beautiful, the males get these beautiful blue heads, bright blue, and that's to attract the female. And they'll walk and then they bob their head up and down when they get closer to the female, to attract the female. It's called a tree agama. Looked like one that just hid away from us over there. Some Franklin's calling. some beautiful big marulas around, and hopefully soon we're going to start getting some fruit, which will be great. I know for a fact I will be walking around picking up marulas and eating them while on game drive. Very rich in vitamin C and very tasty, a little bit sour, but very nice. There's another fruit we get out here called a sour plum. The sour plum is a beautiful red fruit about this size, but it is incredibly sour. The faces you pull when you bite into something so sour, it's very entertaining. Seems to be a much quieter morning today. Hang on, us. Yvonne, all the way from Sweden, you say, I won the sandpiper dance. Thank you, Yvonne. You said there was a rhythm to mine, which is great. Thank you. I saw something flying up. I'm not too sure, everybody. It may have been an owl. I didn't see it very clear. I just caught a glimpse of something flying through this densely wooded area, this drainage line just off to our left. Just going to scan here quickly. Wouldn't be wonderful to see an owl, but as I said, I did not get a good view of it at all. But let's see, you never know. I mentioned it the other day. We were lucky in June while I was here. I managed to find three or four different giant eagle owls, or Varroa's eagle owls. These beautiful big owls, the largest in this area, get to about that size, the giant eagle owl. And we saw a lot of them along this drainage line. We could hear them calling, and often we found them. But since I've been here, I've not seen one on this trip. So it's interesting. I'm not sure where they would have gone. Possibly down towards the rivers, maybe. But I'm not sure. James, you want to know if you can add James and I to your bird list? I don't think it would be accepted. Some birds sitting at the top of the tree over there. What are those? Those grey go-away birds. Oh, the glare, everybody, is difficult, but they are grey go-away birds. And they do that wonderful quay, quay, quay. The grey go away birds. I've been practicing some of my bird calls. Sure, it really is starting to warm up, everybody. I think it's going to be a very hot day. All right, so we're going to continue our search for anything and everything. While we do that, James has got a little pig to show you. Is it waterbuck or warthog?
Brian, does that look like a pig to you?
I didn't quite understand what was said.
No, it doesn't look like a pig to me. I mean, I think that's a waterbuck.
Yes.
Wouldn't you say?
Yes.
Yes. As indicated by the fact that it's taller, really, than a warthog. Other than that, they are imminently confusable, of course. One might also confuse it for a donkey. But it isn't a donkey, is it, Brian?
No.
No, because on a donkey, it would have longer ears.
Yeah. Yes. And they don't have round rings on their buttocks.
They don't have round rings on their buttocks. Good, well, I'm glad we've sorted that out. A waterbuck cow, everybody. there were some impala here, but they've absconded, and in the background, another, yet another, ground hornbill calling. Again? Brian, of course, is now going to create consternation amongst the ground hornbills of the area. Right, I think that we've eked what we can out of that waterbuck sighting. It's just its bottom now disappearing. So here's a question for you, everybody. Why is it, and I'm going to think about this myself because I don't know the answer, why is it that waterbuck, I suppose kudu, to a certain extent, are that greyish-brown colour, whereas impala and steenbok are that rich russet red? Surely there must be an optimum colour to be out here, and why isn't everything that optimum colour? Hashtags for Alive, questions at wilder.tv, terms and conditions apply, batteries not included. Send us through your answers, everybody. I don't know. Well, I've got a vague theory forming in my mind. But, I mean, you can form a theory about anything, really, Brian. So let's try and find out why it is that the waterbuck and the kudu are similarly coloured, and yet buffalo are black, wildebeest are black, steenbok are red, impala are red, giraffe are giraffe coloured, and what was the other one I was thinking of? Dika are grey, much like those things. There's a kudu. You can see that. Oh, that's a horrible noise. Oh, there we have kudu, and you can see they're a similar colour to the waterbuck, but they obviously have much shorter hair. Now for me, they and waterbuck have the ultimate colour. They are perfectly hidden, especially in this kind of vegetation. I might have another theory forming. Anyway, that's the kudu enjoying their new browse. They look pretty good. I don't think they've lost much condition. And the impala are looking pretty ropey, some of them. Now we're right on the corner of the southeastern corner of Juma. That's looks like the old M, doesn't it? Right, Paul, you say that would be boring. Everything needs to be different in order to pick a mate. I'm not sure that would be the real answer, but we'll go with it for now as the only theory put forward. Thank you, Paul. Yeah, that's looks pretty mangy, doesn't it? Right, Dina, you reckon that the waterbuck and kudu blend in with the colours of the trunks of the trees and the branches, and that the russet-coloured ones blend in with the soil. I would believe you, Dina, if the russet ones here, if we had russet-coloured soil, which we do not. We've got very pale soil here, as we were chatting about earlier. So, Dina, I think you're right, first up. I think that if you want to stay camouflaged in dark or in the leafless bush, you want to be the colour of a kudu or the colour of a waterbuck. Now, my theory is as follows. Are you ready, Brian?
I'm ready.
No, except, well, okay, well, let's go with it. My theory is that kudu and waterbuck are big, and they feed, in the case of the kudu, in sort of thickish bush, in the case of the waterbuck, in ecotones, where there are trees. So in the summertime, they're in leafy bush, it's easy for them to hide. In the wintertime, they're in kind of that, pretty much where they are now, in amongst grey and brown vegetation, so it's probably easier for them to hide there. I think the russet ones like kudu and Steenbok, not like impala and Steenbok, tend to spend much more time out in the open. And because they're out in the open, trying to stay too camouflaged is quite difficult. And they therefore, that russet color apparently is quite camouflaged to colorblind animals in against a green background. So I think it's probably got something to do with that. They don't really have the opportunity to hide behind things in the same way that the kudu and the waterbuck do. So they can't blend in. I think we're getting some way there. Why a buffalo and a wildebeest are black? Well, I don't know about that. Good. Brian, are you sore fascinated by our discussion?
Sore fascinated.
Good. That's a very interesting one. Hello, Jane. It's not an easy one to answer, but that's what makes it such a nice question. You say, sorry, James, not Jane, James. We were talking a little bit earlier about whether or not what the long-term effects of humans being extinct in this area would be. And you say, do I think that any animals would actually go extinct as a result of humans going extinct as well? In other words, because you reckon that most animals would increase in the absence of human beings. Just remember that there are things going extinct all the time. But as a direct result of humans going extinct, no, you know, I can't think of one animal that depends on us for its survival. There are many animals that depend on us for their survival, but that's mostly for protection against us as well. So I don't think there are any animals. You say maybe cheetah, I think. I think cheetah will eventually go extinct without our help, and that's simply because don't really have a particularly clever strategy, to be honest, and they're totally over specialized, so they will always be on the brink of sort of endangerment or extinction. I don't know, rhino eventually, but you know, they certainly have sufficient evolutionary adaptations to survive in an area like this. Now, I don't think that the absence of human beings would cause any distress for any animal at all, except the domestic cat and dog. I struggle to imagine that if humans went extinct, that there would be feral packs of chihuahuas running around the place, making a living and actually surviving. I think the chihuahua would go extinct almost immediately, as would that beastly hairless cat. What are they called again? I think the hairless cat would be the Sphinx, that's right. I think they'd be bred out of existence very quickly. I'm just trying to imagine a pack of miniature dachshunds coming running through this area, trying to find themselves a meal to eat. What a horrendous thought. While I consider packs of chihuahuas, feral miniature dachshund and feral Yorkshire terriers coming through this area, let's head across to Byron and find out. I think he's heading towards some Karula tracks.
We've managed to find some elephant first, but yes, it sounds like they got some tracks of Karula again. So we're going to head into that area and try and double check. But we've got a wonderful herd of elephant. So things are happening, everyone. As I said, the bush will eventually deliver for us. Just need patience. And just sitting with my favorite animals, or one of my favorite animals. It's so wonderful to spend time with them and watch them feeding. Aaron, you want to know how well elephants adapt to extreme conditions, and very well, Aaron. They, if you think of the distribution of elephant, African elephant, throughout Africa, and there's a subspecies of forest elephant in parts of, I think, in the Congo, if I'm not mistaken, too. So they're slightly different, but bigger. They're a bit smaller, but they're able to move through the dense forests, whereas the African elephant that's found throughout the rest of Africa, and they do adapt very well to different conditions and harsh conditions. We have the desert elephants up in Namibia. They move through areas where there's very little vegetation and very little water, but they have adapted to survive in those conditions. And even here, when we've had that serious drought, the animals, or these elephant rather, are still able to find food and water. They'll go and dig up little areas in dry riverbeds, and they'll get to water very, very quickly. And so they do adapt extremely well. It's fascinating to see. Really, really intelligent animals. Have a look off to our right, everybody. Just this little baby, very close to us. Oh, look at that. There's another one very close to us, just in front of the vehicle. Have a look at this right here. Kristen, you want to know if there's any inbreeding with elephant, or if they breed outside of the herds. So, Kristen, let's just see what happens here. Hello. Look at that, everyone. Wow. Right next to us. That is so special. That is amazing. That really is wonderful. So, Kristen, getting back to your question, what happens within the elephant herds is it's not usually breeding within the herd that occurs. You have these big dominant bulls which move around, and they'll wait for herds to pass by or find herds, and they will then come in and mate. So the chances of inbreeding within a herd are very slim, and I've actually never heard of it happening. You'll always get some big dominant males that come in from outside to mate with the females in the herd. Look how clever this elephant is, using its tusks to move the trees so it can get to this green grass underneath. Look how it wraps its trunk around and will then break the grass. Amazing. And look at that, you see? And what it's doing there is it's actually just shaking the grass once you get the dust off of it. Watch it. You look at that. Get the sand off. And a little Kaya, you're 4 years old and you're watching for the first time with us. Hello and welcome. It's so nice to have you watching. And you say elephant are your favorites. I'm so happy that you're watching now and you're getting to see these elephants with us. They're so close to us. Look at those long eyelashes. This is very special. Look at that. Here comes another young one coming out. Just inches to the right. You'll see it coming into frame. There we go. Probably about 6 years old, I would say. 5-6 years old. Maybe a bit older. All right, we're going to continue on our search for leopards. This elephant seems to be moving off. While I do that, James has got something very small on the ground that he'd like to show you.
Now, life has exploded here on the ground, and we've managed to get off the car through the use of a very clever cable. And we're sitting on the ground here because there are a number of things I wanted to show you. The first is this baboon spider's web. And this baboon spider is clearly still at home inside, waiting to see if something doesn't come along and walk over the top, get stuck. It'll come out and then bite it to death. Otherwise, what it'll do is climb out at some stage, probably during the evening, and then go hunting and return to this burrow later on. Isn't that lovely? I think that's amazing. There are ants everywhere. There are little plants coming up. And what I did find also here was a mantis. Here it is, Brian. Oh, my goodness. Now, this little mantis. Can you see my grassy pointer? It's a very cryptically coloured mantis. It's a brilliant colour. Can you see it at all? Can you see my pointer?
Yeah, hang on.
Sorry, everybody. This is very difficult. You got him.
Yeah.
There he is. He's now looking at the pointer and at boxing it. The boxing mantis. Remember, we had a boxing mantis once before. So cool. Anyway, those little mantises and things, I guarantee you he's eating ants. They're predatory, so he's probably waiting there carefully to see if he can't catch some ants. There'll be lots of mantises disguised all over the place. There are ants, there are termites, there are dung beetles. As you know, there are cicadas coming out of the ground. This is a result of the rain that we've had, and it's just wonderful to see the life exploding from the earth. Then, one of the other things that has exploded from the earth, well, I wouldn't say explode. Explode is implies some kind of speed, is this thing here. And I showed you the leaf of it the other day. And this is Hibiscus cannabinus. And in it is a beetle. Look at that beetle. Look. How cool is that? Can you see the beetle, Brian?
Yeah.
Look what kind of beetle it is. But it's eating pollen, and clearly this is what pollinates the hibiscus plant, this very special beetle. I don't know what kind of beetle it is. I'm going to get in your way if I try and see it. Yeah, that's fascinating. Orange and black on the wings. Looks like the shape of a jewel beetle, but I don't think it is one. And its face is now covered in its breakfast. That's how my brother used to eat ice creams. In fact, he still does. Stunning. Isn't that cool? That really is rather amazing. So all of these hibiscuses will now start to pop up out the ground. We're waiting for the first lily. I have seen one lily, but it wasn't quite open yet, somewhere around Twin Dams. Anyway, we're going to continue on, and we'll head off probably towards Treehouse Dam and see what we can see there. But until then, are we going to link?
Not yet.
We're just waiting to find out?
Yeah, we can link.
Oh, we are going to link. Byron, I think, is probably still with Karula. We'll get back on the car and see you shortly.
So we haven't quite seen the tracks just yet. We're heading into the area. We're not too far, but we've managed to find a beautiful group of zebra, everyone. So we are heading, we're not far from that area where they had tracks of Karula. So we'll try and give the other guide a hand. I think Aubrey's in the area. Let's see if we can find that beautiful female leopard. But in the meantime, we've got magnificent zebra. off they go. A dazzle of zebra. That's what a group of zebra are known as. I know some of you do enjoy the collective nouns that we use for some of the animals. And it's known as a dazzle of zebra, and the dazzle have disappeared. Let's see what else we can find. I wonder where Karula is hiding at the moment. Must be in this area somewhere.
There's monkeys alarm calling somewhere around Lake Mohawk. I'm going to go check it out.
James, you wanted to know if we have African wildcats coming around the camp at night. James, I haven't seen here. I have seen in one or two other camps before. I've seen African wildcats come and have a look around in the evenings. But generally, the wildcats are quite shy little creatures. And you don't often see them wandering around too close to the lodges. But in saying that, it does happen. I've had hyena regularly coming around. Porcupine. And what else? You know, little creatures, honey badgers, perhaps. So all those little creatures, they do come around at night. The civet that we spoke about this morning. They will come around and wander through the camps looking for food, perhaps little jennets. And over here we've got some buffalo. Everyone, there's a herd of buffalo. Hang on, I'll just try to get us into a nice position. What about through there? Is that okay? Can see all the buffalo around everyone? Oh, nice. And we've been seeing a lot of buffalo tracks around, and I think there's one or two herds that keep moving through this area. And then probably one of the herds that the lions have been hunting from. Tracy in New York, you wanted to know, are there any solutions that the animals use in nature to ward off flies or keep flies away? So Tracy, usually what happens is all these trees I think we've lost audio, everyone. I'm not sure if you are you good on my. Okay, so Dave can still hear me. Oh dear. Okay. So Tracy, you want to know how the animals keep flies off of them? So a lot of the animals have got long tails and. They'll constantly flick their tails around and keep flies off them that way. Otherwise, some of the zebra, for example, the zebra have got a great technique. What they do is they stand head to tail, and while they're facing opposite directions, they'll flick their tails around, keep the flies away and that from their faces. Other animals will go and roll in mud and mud wallow and dust bathe. All of that also helps keep flies and ticks off of them. So there are different techniques. But those would probably be the most common and ones that we see happening on a regular basis. These animals go and roll around in the sand, in the dust, or they'll go and wallow in the mud or splash mud on themselves. And then also just the tails flicking constantly backwards and forwards, trying to chase the flies away. Nice to see this herd of buffalo. We better be careful, the lions are around. Now, this is an interesting little tree I'd like to show you. Just getting back to that question about the flies. Hang on, let me just see if I can get... Dave, just see if you can get a glimpse of that little bush over there. Let me just move a little bit more. Oh, is that this little one right next to us? Now, this is called an ivy grape, everyone, or Cissus cornifolia. And this ivy grape, there's a theory, it's got these leaves that they folded actually, and if you have a look, you can see in my hand, look how they folded. But now, so now what I wanted to show you is, you asked about flies and that. Now apparently, if you take these Cissus cornifolia leaves, or this ivy grape, these leaves, and it's got quite a pungent smell, everyone, and you break them and you rub them on your skin, apparently it keeps the flies away. I remember learning about this a while ago, before I started guiding. And it has got quite a pungent smell, which is interesting. You wouldn't expect it to keep flies away, but apparently it does work. But I remember when we were training, and we found this little bush, and I identified it, and I said to James, I said, you know, and apparently if you rub it on your face, it'll keep the flies away. And James smelt it, and he said, well, yes, I think that pungent smell will keep everything away, not just the flies. So I don't know if it really works, but I have seen people try it, and I've tried it a little bit, but at the moment there aren't any flies bothering us. So maybe I'll keep it just in case, and if we get some flies, I'll rub some on my face and we'll see what happens. Let's carry on. We're going to leave the buffalo in search of Karula, and it would be lovely to find that female. All right, we're going to continue searching, and while I do, let's head back to James for an update and see what he's got.
We have the most bizarre situation here, everybody. We came into this area because there are monkeys going ballistic. There's one up there, we'll show you. But as we came along, we found one on the ground, a big male, alarm calling on the ground. We immediately thought there must be a leopard in this area, and some of them are looking off to the direction that one's looking, which is towards the Morwati. But why there should have been one on the ground, and then he was going completely different direction. So I don't know what's going on here. There are no leopard tracks. But this is a favorite haunt of Karulas. It's also possible that it's the youngsters, maybe. I don't know, that she's left the youngsters here. One is still calling. The one that was on the ground had run off that way, but almost like he's searching for something. That one is looking straight down in there. I don't know, it's all very confusing. Let's go round to the drainage line again. We might be lucky there. The first one that we came across was on the ground, just on the ground here, and it was just doing this full alarm call. It's still calling just up ahead. And it's going crazy around here, actually. It's now up in a tree looking down here. I'm not going to try and show it to you. I'm just going to move a little bit in case whatever it is, I think is moving. look over the road here, just to make sure there isn't something crossing. So it's up in those tall trees there. Scan the ground here. This is round about where Karula left the youngsters. I'm gonna scan the bush here, everybody. The monkey's looking directly towards this direction. This is very strange. Karula left the youngsters here. Maybe the youngsters were split up. Maybe Tingana's come back. Maybe there's a snake that's eaten a little one already. And that monkey is very, very cross. It's not happy at all. Let's go back towards it. I mean, there really is nothing obvious going on here, though. Well, the tree that the monkey's in is just up ahead here. There. See there? Brian, up in that, the second tree there. Aubrey's just calling on the radio. Go ahead, Orbs. Aubrey, go ahead. So now it's looking down towards the more white. Orbs, I've got them here pretty much just to the north of the junction with Leadwood Road. They're looking down towards the Mulwati, but they're calling from two or three different places. Okay. Aubrey will come and give us a hand here. I don't know. I mean, they are not happy, these things. Top there, very top. You see him there, Brian?
Yeah.
He's looking straight down towards the Leadwood tree here. That's the one we saw on the ground, everyone. He was making that noise right next to us. Of course, the longer we wait, the less chance there is that we'll see. Yeah, I think we need to go and head towards the junction of the Mulwati. They do have excellent eyes. Brian and I discovered once when we were out here and they started calling roughly the same place. We found quarantine, what, Brian, 400 meters from where they were calling?
Yeah.
And it wasn't like he was moving. He was completely static on a termite mound, but they'd spotted him from a huge distance away. Now we did do a brief foray through this drainage line before we came to see you, or you came to see us. I mean, it could be as far away as Twin Dams, you know. They won't be able to see into the drainage. So I think we need to go up the other side. This is where we found Karula and cubs the other day. Thanks to the guinea fowl that was shouting at them. There, leopard. Jason, you say, could an eagle snatch a monkey? Yes, indeed. That, everyone, I believe. is what the problem is. I think it's who I said I thought it was. Is it? Who is that? Orbs, I've got a leopard here, but south of the boundary, just at Twin Dams. Yeah, it looks like Karula. Would you agree, Brian?
Yeah.
Oh, she's just disappeared. Anyway, that's what those monkeys were shouting at. And yet again, Brian, our little theory of their incredible eyesight is proven. Shfambile. Shfambe so. Yeah. Sor. So she's disappeared, I'm afraid. But where are the babies? That's what worries me. Well, it doesn't worry me, I'm just interested. And I wonder if she hasn't left them where she left them before. Oh, what a pity. They can still see her, they're still calling those monkeys. Anyway, at least we saw a leopard. That was very nice. We'll carry on along here and see if she doesn't pop out. I don't think she's going to pop out here. Look, you know what? She may well have taken the cubs in there and maybe she's killed and maybe, you know what? I think that's probably exactly what's happened. I wonder if she hasn't killed up here and maybe she's going to fetch the cubs. So that's a good prospect for this afternoon. How cool is that? That's really nice. I know it wasn't the best sighting in the world, but we had a very nice view of her. And it's always nice to find a leopard like that after doing a little bit of intuitive guesswork.
And it saves the cat stream.
And it saves the cat stream, yes. But we did have the, I suppose we did have the lions this morning, yes. Marvellous. Yes. Great success, as Borat would say. Right, we'll head towards Treehouse Dam now. She's gone down in there and I suspect it's to fetch the cubs. All right, in the meantime, Brian and I will bask in our joy. Let us head across to Byron and find out how his tracking of the leopards that side is going.
Wow, that's amazing, James. Well done. I'm so glad you got to see a leopard, even though it was a brief glimpse. That is incredible. That really is great. We've seen the tracks of Karula, and she... I'm not sure if that was a leopard that you saw. I don't know. I don't think so. I mean, because just judging by where we've got tracks of this female now, I think she's possibly still in this block somewhere. So we're having a good look, but it's very, very thick. I heard some impala alarm calling briefly, but we went to have a look and we found the impala. They stopped. It wasn't serious alarm calls, and I think perhaps what was happening is the males occasionally do that so they keep the females close to them. But yeah, no sign of anything, unfortunately. Not yet, anyway. Lauren, you want to know if there are any black leopards close to here? Lauren, not that I know of. I'm trying to think. I haven't heard of black leopards being seen in the Kruger at all. But in an area known as Lydenburg, which is probably, from here, it's probably a two-hour drive, I would say, Lydenburg, hour and a half to two-hour drive from here. Directly west, so you actually have to go through the Drakensberg mountain range or over the Drakensberg mountain range, and there's a small little town and there the mountains within that area, apparently that's where black leopards have been seen. I've never seen one before, but apparently they do occur in that area. Trying to listen to see, there are one or two other vehicles in this area, so if they get any sign of a leopard, they'll let us know. But we have not seen anything yet. And it goes back to what I was saying earlier, everyone. I'm sure there's more than one, guaranteed there's more than one leopard moving through these areas. It's just a case of finding them. And there's definitely been a few tracks around. We had tracks of a male this morning, the tracks of Karula. James found that leopard. Was it Karula? I don't think so, judging by the area that we've got the tracks in. But I could be wrong, because they do move around a lot, and they do move through different areas very, very quickly. But it is interesting and it is exciting because we don't know. Unless we get a confirmed sighting where we can say, right, this is this leopard, or find the different leopards in the different areas. Having a close look around this area on the edge of the thicket line, very close to drainage, and it would be ideal for leopards to move through and to hide, so who knows. There goes a water buck just running in front of us. Ah, warthogs, sorry, the brakes are making noise, and off they go. A little bit shy this morning, the warthogs, and they move very, very quickly. Oh, look at that! They also one of my favorites. I love the look at that hairstyle. That's impressive. Looks like it's been straightened by something. What do the girls use, David? GHD. maybe the warthog's got a GHD hidden somewhere. Kirsten's laughing at me. Look at that. That is a fantastic hairstyle blowing in the wind. Isn't that great? Wow. Impressive. Who was that male model? Fabio, with the long hair. There it goes, Fabio. Kirsten is giving me a fact, but I'd hate to admit it, but I actually knew this. So, Kirst, thank you, but I did know that the GHD, the hair straightener, stands for good hair day, and Kirsten says I shouldn't admit it, but I'm being honest with everyone today. So, I did know that. Look at these beautiful waterbuck. Those are impressive males, everyone. Those horns, really wide, curved horns. These are very big males. Also, just stopping and listening, you know, James found that leopard purely because the monkeys were alarm calling in that area, which alerted him as to where to go and look. And we often, 80% of the time we rely on alarm calls to find animals. And I'm just listening just to hear if anything does give an alarm call, then might help us find a predator. If there is one in the area, again, I'm not sure. But we'll see. There's that beautiful white ring around the rump. And the theory is that it is one of the following mechanisms for them to follow each other away from danger. Wow, it really is warming up already, everyone. And it's about 25 to 8 in the morning here, and it really feels like we're pushing 28 or 30 degrees Celsius, which is probably around, 80 Fahrenheit, maybe a bit more. 85 Fahrenheit. Jane, you wanted to know why the other waterbuck species, the one that we find, I think it's Central Africa, if I'm not mistaken. They've got a different following mechanism. Now, I don't, unfortunately, have a mammals book of Africa. I've only got Southern Africa. I'm not sure why the following mechanism is different, but it's different subspecies, different markings. It's just like every other antelope that's got different following mechanisms or bright white markings on the rump. But there are theories, and we've discussed it a few times in length with some other guides. And is it really a startle following mechanism? Is it there to say, follow me, let's get out of danger, I know where to go? Or is it a case where they just become alerted and they flash this white to possibly confuse the predator? I don't know, because some antelope have the white under the tail, some have it just marked on the rump. They are all theories, and I say that because nothing's actually been scientifically proven. And it's interesting, because then we get to have these conversations and we get to try and work out why are these markings there. Is it for this reason, or is it for something else perhaps? So it is interesting, and it is something that we discuss on a regular basis. And I don't think there's a right answer, but I do believe that the markings around the rump to... white markings around the rump or under the tail are there to an extent for them to follow each other out of danger. They flash this white and then they're able to see where each other run and possibly keep the group together. Safety in numbers might be easier to keep the predators at bay. So I think there is something to that theory, some bit of truth. But it's an interesting topic, because like I said, we've discussed it in length many times, and who knows what the right answer is. Nice to see those big waterbuck. And the warthogs are still running off in front of us. So, Dog Tranquility, you would like to know why the warthogs, and they're actually right here, why the warthogs put their tails up when they run. Look at that, feeding wonderful. So, why the warthogs put their tails up when they run is because, if you have a look, their skin is very, very, very tight around that body. And when they run, and they run at really, I mean, they run very, very quickly. And when they're running, their eyes start to water, so they clench their eyes closed when they're running so fast. And when they do that, because the skin is so tight, it causes the tail to stand up. I am obviously joking, everybody. I'm joking. It's not the reason. Dave, is that the first time you heard that? Yeah. Okay, no, that is a joke, everyone. That is not the reason. What happens is generally it is also a following mechanism. So as they run, their tail pops up so that they can follow each other through long grass. That is the theory behind why the tail rises as soon as they start running. So not because their skin is tight, no, but it is apparently a following mechanism. So as they run, the tails extend up, and then they can see the little black tufts, and they can follow each other through the long grass. All right, we're going to continue our search around this drainage line, see what we can find. James has got some beefalo that he'd like to show you.
There they are, over there, everybody. Can you see? Yes, very good, Brian. That was an interesting link, wasn't it? Fascinating. We have another small herd of emaciated buffalo coming loping across the road at a very slow speed. Oh, good morning. That's Wabul, and then off to the right-hand side, there's a cow. She's also walking very slowly, trying to get to the water. In need of some kind of sustenance. Hello. I am astounded at how badly the buffalo are doing. And this is post that first rain, you know. This is a long-term effect they're feeling. It is why they are being smashed to smithereens by the lions. They are weak. It's really rather sad. I was kind of making light of it, but it's not easy for them. And just, if you don't mind, Brian, over there to the right, to the left, the big bull. Well, big bulls and sort of moot term. It's browsing still, it's not grazing. And I really think this is a function of the design of their mouths. I don't think that they're able to get at the very short grass. And I think that means that although there is a green flush everywhere, this cow is very close to us, although there is a green flush of grass everywhere, I just don't think that it's... I don't think it's reachable. I don't think it's exploitable by the buffalo. Finding it really tough to try and find things to eat. And so they're browsing. Now that is not a scene you see every day. Buffalo are known to browse, but not, I mean, that's a Cambretum bush. It's full of tannin. And so while there will be nutrition for the buffalo to eat, there's a lot of toxin there that it's not specifically designed to cope with. They're designed to cope with long grass, which they crop with their tongues. They wrap their tongues around it and then pull. Very difficult for them to take the short grass off the ground. I mean, they really do look miserable walking very slowly. They never look particularly cheerful, mind. You can see him eating on his tree there. A very, very nice question from Mr. Fuzzman Sparkles today. Fuzzman Sparkles, you say, do I think that the animals out here, in other words, the prey animals, the herbivores, will ever start to associate vehicles with cats? And my answer to you is, I suppose they would. If we only ever spent time with cats, then yes, I think they would. They would make that association. And if they were constantly killed around the vehicles, in other words, if, you know, every time they were killed, there was a vehicle nearby, I absolutely think that they would make that association. But I think that we are not with the cats all the time, A. And B, I'm just listening to the radio quickly. There he is. Just an update on Karula, who is still south. So I just, I think we spend enough time with them not around cats for them not to associate us with cats. Very good question. I certainly think they have the capability, though, of working something like that out. All right, on we go. And Adam, following on from that, you're wondering, do I think that the animals see this vehicle and us in it as some strange animal, or do they just ignore it? They don't just ignore it all the time. They have to get used to it. They have to get acclimatized to it. So they don't ignore us completely. I do think that they think it's some strange, benign animal that doesn't do any harm but is potentially dangerous, which is why they're a little bit wary. And then slowly they learn that it isn't dangerous at all and they don't worry about it anymore. But what is, of course, the most interesting thing is that you can drive around here on an open vehicle. I mean, Brian is pretty exposed at the back there. And we could never get anything like this close to the animals on foot. They would be totally terrified of us, and they would either react aggressively or react by running away. And in the vehicle, it just isn't like that for some reason. For some reason, they... a predator sees extremely well. As a friend of mine once said, you can't tell me a leopard doesn't look at a vehicle and see a human being, because, I mean, a leopard can spot a monkey's ear just from sticking out from the side of a tree. There's no ways that it doesn't see our faces on the vehicle here. But it's just because it's so unfamiliar to them. It's so, there's no genetic memory or physical memory of a human being a danger in this kind of context. And so they just don't worry about us. Which I think is fascinating. I was hearing a story the other day, however. Steph told me a story about a leopard who managed to hurt or injure 15 people. They were on the back of a car. It had been harassed, but it knew exactly what to attack when it decided that it wanted to attack. On that note, let's head across to Byron. He's back with the Nkuhuma Pride.
After that story that James told you, I gave up leopard tracking because I got too scared. So we've come to the lions. The lions have moved down into the shade, everyone. And it's so nice to see all of them again, all the little cubs. No, so unfortunately, no further sign of any leopards around. It's getting quite hot, so I think chances of finding a leopard moving around now are quite slim. But you never know, there could still be something that pops up. Oh, look at those cubs cleaning themselves, enjoying the shade. Looks like that one's, looks almost like it's got its paws interlinked. Julie, you want to know if animals always have to stay out of sight of the lions. And no, Julie, not at all. I've seen on many occasions, and depending on the areas and where these lions are found and the habitat, you'll get lions that are feeding, perhaps, or drinking at a water hole, and there will be other animals wandering around. They just keep their distance. But as long as they can see the lions and make sure that the lions don't have an element of surprise with them, then they'll be fine. And so a lot of the time I've seen lions lying down, sleeping, there'll be other animals around. There was a giraffe around earlier that I saw not too far from here, so not too far from the lions, but that giraffe's eyesight is very good and possibly would have seen the lions already. Wonderful Cape turtle dove calling. Work harder, work harder. Oh, that's lovely. Look at the pride, very relaxed, enjoying that cool sand. And it's so interesting, everyone. We found these lions now. We've been so fortunate. We've found them every day. I think we're almost on day 60, 59 or somewhere around there of big cats, which is incredible. But now these lions, the last week or so, we've had some overcast, cool mornings, and we've had some really hot mornings like this morning. And we've seen how the behavior changes. So we've seen these lions lying out in the open, completely in the open, at 9 o'clock in the morning because there's no sun and it's not too warm. But now, much, much earlier, and these lions have been down here for a while, probably an hour already, because it has become so hot and so warm already. So they prefer to move down into the shade, into this drainage line, which is a really, really nice area for them. And they'll rest here during the course of the day and then eventually move on a little bit later. Possibly try and hunt again tonight. But we know that these lions have been feeding on buffalo just about every day. They've been very successful. Madison, you want to know if the female cubs would find, or if they'd stay within the pride when they get older? They will definitely stay within the pride, Madison. The female cubs stay within the pride, and that just increases the size of the pride. It's highly unlikely that they would move off and go and find another pride that they join. That wouldn't happen because, for one thing, the other lionesses will act aggressively towards and probably attack them. So they'll stay within this pride. I have seen, however, Madison, I've seen lions when new males come into an area. I've seen where the lioness that has got cubs has taken those cubs and run away with them. And the reason for that is she feared for their safety. She didn't want the males to attack the young cubs. So she fled and moved away with those cubs, and the other females stayed and mated with those males. And a year and a half later, those lions and the cubs actually returned and tried to move back into that pride, and there was so much aggressive behavior between those lions, they didn't allow those cubs back into the pride, which was interesting. So those lions actually then formed their own pride. There were just four of them, and those four lionesses formed their own pride, and they are very successful, and they're on Londolozi at the moment. They are known as the Mungen pride. Those of you who do follow the lions within the Sabi Sands, that Mungen pride was actually part of the Salala pride. And those four females, young females with the oldest adult female, they ran away and moved to the west and eventually set up a territory of their own. And they now have their own cubs, those four females. They've done very, very well. So they have been around the Mungen pride. They've grown quite a bit. But that happened in 2010, which is very interesting. So it can happen that they'll split off and possibly form their own pride or start their own pride, but chances of them going and joining another pride are highly, highly unlikely, especially females. Usually what happens is the females will just grow up within the pride and stay within the pride. A beautiful orange-breasted bush shrike calling at the moment. That's the orange-breasted bush shrike. Now, Kirsten says it looks like there might be some elephant. Oh, right, yeah, there we go. It is very scary how we have these eyes all over the show watching us. But look at this wonderful scene, everyone. The impala drinking, the elephant right next to us. And then we've got these lions off to our right. And look how the impala have scattered, because the elephants often don't like sharing the water holes, so they'll chase other animals. Oh, this is beautiful. And it's interesting to see how these elephants go, and they splash the water a little bit, try and get rid of some of the mud, and then they'll try and drink the clean water. And they really are going to enjoy that drink now. They'll probably drink on a hot day like today. They'll probably drink a few times a day, not just once. It's maybe the first drink of the day. And all the impala down surrounding them. Oh, what a fantastic way to end, isn't this? Just beautiful, lovely scene. And we have the hippo just in the foreground, also in the dam. There's the hippo. He's watching the elephant. Look at that. Hippo, impala, elephant. Birds calling. Nice cool breeze, actually, all of a sudden. I'm going to move forward slightly, just quickly, because James is trying to sneak up behind me, but he's doing so quite loudly. So let's make space for James so he can perhaps enjoy the sighting with us. It'll be interesting to see how that young elephant reacts to those impala off to the left. Just watch, see the ears open. And these youngsters, are, you know, they're learning all the time. So they... So watch, there we go. That little one. Just a flick of the trunk. And chasing the impala again. This is my waterhole. This really, really is wonderful. Just a very, very peaceful scene. And to think there are lions just behind us, everyone. On the other side, they're still lying down there. What is James doing? James is trying to do a 62-point turn on the dam wall. he's now turned around. And there go the Ellies. Alright, well, a lovely way to end the morning, everyone. No luck with the leopard, but that's how it goes sometimes. We'll try again this afternoon on our sunset safari. And a big thank you to all our viewers. I am going to bid you farewell for the day. I hope you have a wonderful day or evening wherever you are. So thank you very much. Thank you to Dave on camera with me this morning. And let's head back to James, find out what he was doing behind me. Goodbye, everyone.
What I was looking for behind Byron, everybody, was my lens cap, which I have lost again. I lose it 8 times a day. But what I wanted to show you, we were asked about, remember earlier on we were chatting about the soil and the colour of the soil and the sodic soil. And this is an Acacia gerardii or red thorn tree. And if you see them, you can be fairly sure that what you've got is sodic soil. You can see the pale soil here. And then for the last 2 minutes of our drive, I know Byron was looking at those elephants, but they've moved off towards the pan where there is some cleaner water for them. So let's go and have a look at them there. There they are. Very comfortably drinking. Just try and get a little bit closer to them, sneak past. Oh, just look at the pipe here quickly, Brian. The pipe. See how they've pulled it out, everybody? That's the pipe that feeds this pan. Anyway, back to the elephants. And there they are. So keep an eye on the dam cam during the course of the day. We think it's going to get pretty hot. At the moment, it's a very pleasant temperature, but every so often the sun breaks through the cloud and it does get very hot indeed. And that means that there will be action here. There was lots of action going on here yesterday. Elephants and buffalo and various other things. And now maybe this little herd will walk past us. Anyway, While we wait for that to happen, as these elephants come to bid you all a fond farewell, I hope you had a wonderful drive. We really did see some pretty good stuff, didn't we? Some interesting banter, that ridiculous dance we did. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you
to Byron and to David and to Kirsten Max-Smith and Louise Pavid in the final control, and mostly, of course, to all of you from home. We'll see you later at 4 o'clock this afternoon, so stay safe and happy until then. Bye-bye.